So today, once again, we are going to continue our discussion with the terminologies those are being used in machine learning. So let's have a recap what we have seen earlier. So we have talked about inductive learning. We know that objects or observations are represented by making use of the features. So features are the properties, those are describing the objects. Usually, to represent or to describe the object, we make use of more than one features. So if more than one features are being used to describe one object or one observation, then we say that it is a feature vector. So usually feature vectors are describing the objects or observations. To deal with machine learning problems like regression or classification, what is important is once we have been provided with our training data set, this collection of instances, the collection of observations typically forms the feature space. So once I'm having the training data, I need to make use of some algorithm, some kind of machine learning representation to come up with the prediction. So we have gone through one term, that is hypothesis. So hypothesis is a function that helps us to label the data. So mathematical function that is being used for prediction is nothing but the hypothesis. But as we have seen that it is possible for us to have more than one hypothesis. So the set of all such legal hypotheses is known as a hypothesis space. So we are having the hypothesis space wherein we may have all the possible functions, all the possible hypotheses. And what we need to do is we need to pick the best one which is suitable for the given problem. Right? Also, we have gone through several representations. Those can be used to solve the problems in machine learning. Like we have gone through the linear function that can be used for regression. We have seen multivariate function. We have also seen the decision tree kind of a classifier, how we can use that. We have seen or introduced only some part that is of perceptron and also the multi-layer neural network. So we know what kinds of representations we may have. And all those kinds of representations actually we are going to discuss in our course. So in continuation with this discussion, today we are going to discuss one important concept, and that is the size of hypothesis space. So as I mentioned, hypothesis space includes many number of functions. Right? It is a collection of hypotheses. So if I am having many hypotheses and if I need to pick one, I need to do something. Right? So just to give you one example, I am discussing here one problem to just let you know what kind of size we may have for the hypothesis space, right? So let us see one example for that. Let us assume that we are having the Boolean features. We know what is feature. So usually the features are describing the objects. So let us assume that we are having the Boolean features. What we mean by Boolean features? Boolean features are the features those are actually having the value either 0 or 1. So what we mean by that, suppose I'm having two Boolean features, x1 and x2. I'm having two Boolean features, say x1 and x2. What I mean by that, x1 may have the value 0 or 1, and also x2 may have value 0 or 1. Are you getting me? This is what we mean by Boolean features. The features, those can have only two values, 0 or 1. True or false? Are you getting me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, let us assume that we are having only two features. So, how many possible combinations we may have for these two features? I will repeat the question. Four combinations.
Four combinations.
Correct, na? So, x1 may have the value 0 and at the same time, x2 may have the value 0. x1 is having the value 0, but now x2 is having value 1. x1 may have the value 1 and x2 is having value 0. x1 is having value 1 and x2 is having value 1. So how many possible combinations we have here for two Boolean features? We may have four combinations. Right? So if I am having four such Boolean inputs, I am trying to extend our problem. If I am having four such input features, those are Boolean, then obviously I'll be having possible combinations 2 to the power 4. And these combinations are actually the possible instances in my feature space. I'll repeat. If I'm having 4 input features which are Boolean, then obviously I'll be having the possible number of instances in my feature space equal to 2 to the power 4. That means 16. Do you agree with me? If I'm having 3 input features, I'll be having possible instances 2 to the power 3. That means 8. Do you agree with me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Fine. So, this is how we are stating our problem. So, depending on the features and depending on the number of features, it is possible to have number of possible instances in our feature space. So, for simplicity, we are saying that we are having Boolean features to restrict the values. Right? So, for simplicity, we are having here one example wherein we are saying that we are having the Boolean features. So, if I am having 4 Boolean features, then I will be having possible number of instances equal to 2 to the power 4, that means 16. And now, interestingly, if I am having 4 input features, Boolean features, then the number of Boolean functions, those are possible, that means the number of possible subsets of 16 instances is equal to 2 to the power 16. Or in other words, we may say that it is 2 to the power 4. So it comes out to be 65536. So just imagine, for 4 Boolean input features, I may have the number of Boolean functions, those are equal to 65,536, and that defines my size of the hypothesis space. So I may have those many functions available for 4 inputs, 4 Boolean inputs. So just imagine the size of the hypothesis space, the number of functions, those might be available for me. from where I can pick in one function that is most suitable. Right? So obviously you may think that such kind of a problem wherein my size of the hypothesis space is too big, right, is really very time consuming to pick one such hypothesis that is most suitable for me. So in general, if I say that if I am having n number of Boolean features, then obviously the number of possible instances equal to 2 to the power n, and the number of possible functions equal to 2 to the power n, right? So this is only meant for Boolean features having only two possible values, 0 and 1. But if I am having the features, those may have any kind of real value in some range, then just imagine the number of instances we may have and the number of possible functions we may come up with. Okay, for sake of simplicity, we are just mentioning everything related to the Boolean features and Boolean functions, right? But still, the size of the hypothesis space is too big, right? And we need to minimize our search now for the hypothesis, right, in this huge hypothesis space. So what we can do is, we can introduce now one more concept here, and that is called as the inductive bias. So what we mean by inductive bias that we are going to discuss next. So as I mentioned, choosing now a proper hypothesis from a huge hypothesis space needs some kind of assumptions, right? So if I am having a huge hypothesis space, to come up with a particular hypothesis, I need to have some kinds of assumptions. And actually, the assumptions, those are made to make the hypothesis easier to learn, is known as the inductive bias. I'll repeat, what is inductive bias? Inductive bias are the assumptions, those we are going to have to make our hypothesis easier to learn, to minimize the search in hypothesis space. We are imposing some kinds of assumptions, and these assumptions are actually known as the inductive bias. So there are two kinds of inductive biases. So what are those two types of inductive biases? The first is known as the restriction bias. I'll repeat. The first is known as the restriction bias. So what we mean by this restriction bias? Obviously, the restriction bias is limiting our hypothesis space. The restriction bias is limiting our hypothesis space. So what we mean by that? As I mentioned, our hypothesis space is too huge. It is too big. So we would like to have some kind of restriction so that our hypothesis space comparatively becomes smaller, from which we can pick up a particular hypothesis that is a function. Okay, so we are going to impose some restrictions. And if we are going to impose some restrictions on my hypothesis space, then we will say that it is a restriction bias. So bias is nothing but the assumption or the restriction here that we are imposing on our hypothesis space. So what kind of restriction we may have? Say for example, if we are dealing with a regression problem. We know what is regression problem now. Okay, so if we have been presented with few examples, and if we need to find out a line, let us assume a simple regression problem that we have discussed in the last session. we are having only one input, that is X, and associated output, that is Y. And we are having lots of points distributed in this space. Right? So those are my training samples. Correct? And in regression, what we do? We try to pick up a line. Right? That is a best fit for whatever training samples I have. So this is a simple regression problem. But as I stated, we may have the multiple features. So my space, feature space, would be n-dimensional or multidimensional, right? So in such multidimensional space, okay, I need to come up with some function which is my hypothesis. And as I stated, if I'm having n number of features, depending upon the values of those features, I may have a huge feature space. Number of instances are huge. Also, I'll be having a huge hypothesis space. So it is possible for me to have any kind of such function. So I need to restrict now my hypothesis space. So under restriction bias, we are imposing some assumption. We are imposing some restriction, like I want only the linear function. Or my restriction may be, I want to come up with the hypothesis which is a polynomial. So that is my restriction. So in my hypothesis space, original hypothesis space, it is possible for me to come up with a function that might be linear function, that might be a polynomial, right? But now I am restricting, I am imposing the bias. And that is a restriction bias, such that I will say that even though there is a possibility that I am having many number of functions and of different kind, I am restricting my hypothesis space such that I want only the linear functions. I do not want polynomial functions. That is my restriction. Or I may say that I only want the polynomial functions, not any other kinds of function. So this is another kind of restriction. So depending on my need, I may restrict, I may put the bias on my hypothesis space, so that I will have now the subset of hypothesis from which I can pick. So instead of having a huge hypothesis space, by imposing the restriction bias, I'm trying to limit my hypothesis space. I'm trying to pick a subset of my hypothesis space. And the restriction would be like just picking up the linear function, or just picking up the polynomial, or having only the Boolean function, whatever it may be the restriction, to come up with a subset of my hypothesis space. Are you getting me? If you have any doubts, please let me know.
Ma'am. Hello.
Yes.
Ma'am, why it is named as inductive bias? Why we can't call it like simply bias?
See, why I don't know why you are messing up with the terms. In any theory, the researchers or the scientists are coming up with some relevant terminology. And as we have discussed already, the relevant terminology that was proposed by the researchers in this domain, they mentioned that it is inductive learning. And already I had a discussion for inductive learning. Inductive learning, in fact, deals with inducting the number of samples, the number of observations into my problem space, and based on induction of such samples, it is possible for us to learn and that is why they have proposed this term, inductive learning. So with respect to inductive learning, we are having this another term, that is inductive bias. So inductive learning needs to have this inductive bias. And the reason just I mentioned, that these are the assumptions, those are made to restrict the hypothesis space, which is too big in size. So inductive bias is a terminology proposed, not by me, that is proposed by the scientist. And this is related with inductive learning, and that is why the relevant terminology is being adopted, that is inductive bias. Bias is some kind of assumption, some kind of restriction that we are imposing to come up with or to restrict our set of hypothesis space. So as I mentioned, inductive bias is having two types. The first that we have discussed right now, that is a restriction. So restriction bias is a kind of a bias that is actually limiting the hypothesis space by typically specifying the form of the function that we would like to use. So hypothesis that I want is only of the kind of linear function. So if I put that restriction, then obviously out of the huge hypothesis space, it is possible for me to come up with a small subset of that hypothesis space. So that is a bias. So please don't have a mess in your mind regarding the terminology. Those terminologies are relevant with the topic, and those are proposed by the researchers, and that is why we are using the same terminologies. And it is really important to understand those terminologies. There is nothing like why this name, and I have explained earlier also, inductive means we are inducting some data, and based on that data, based on these kinds of inductive biases, we are coming up with the learning mechanism. And that is why there is a term induction. Opposite to induction, we are having another term, that is deduction. So deduction means we are eliminating something, but we are not eliminating here anything in this kind of a learning mechanism. We are inducting the things. We are making use of the samples. Those are being introduced by means of the training data set. And we are making use of all those samples of different kinds to learn. And that is why it is very appropriate to use this term inductive learning. I hope you are clear with the concepts.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
So, any doubts so far? Have you understood the restrictive bias? May I proceed with the next kind of the bias?
Yes, ma'am.
So the next type of bias is the preference bias. So what we mean by this preference bias? So this is actually another kind of assumption that we are having. So we are imposing here the ordering on hypothesis space. So what we mean by that, imposing ordering on hypothesis space? What we mean by that? Say for example, we have put the restriction on our hypothesis space. That is, and that restriction is, let us assume that the restriction is we want only, say, polynomial functions. Okay, so this is the restriction. So after having this restriction, it is possible for me to reduce the size of the hypothesis space. But now, still, even though I have reduced the size of my hypothesis space, and even though I'm saying that I'm interested in on only the polynomial functions, I'm having many such polynomial functions with various degrees of the polynomials. So further, I am putting one more assumption, and that assumption or that bias is known as the preferential bias or the preference. So what I mean by that, even though the polynomial hypothesis space I have selected, now I will prefer to use only the polynomial functions, say with lower degrees. So I may have a polynomial with degree 2, I may have a polynomial with degree 3, 4, 5, and even I may have a polynomial with degree 10, 12, whatever it may be, right? So even though I have restricted my hypothesis space to a polynomial space now, I'm putting one preference over that. And what is that preference? Even though lots of polynomial functions are available, now I will prefer to use only the lower degree polynomials because those are more simpler. Right? So that is now the preference that I am having. Okay? So please understand these two kinds of biases, restriction bias and the preference bias. In restriction bias, we are limiting our hypothesis space by imposing the restriction on the kind of function that we are going to use. So we have restricted our hypothesis space. And further, out of that, it is possible for us to put a preference on that subset of my hypothesis space. And the preference might be, like, if I have imposed the restriction that I want to make use of only the polynomial functions, further, I will put the preference bias that out of those polynomials, now I will prefer to use lower degree polynomials. Right? So these are two important kinds of biases that we may have. And this is meant for minimizing the size of my hypothesis space. And with the example, I have explained you what we mean by a size of the hypothesis space and what kind of huge size we may have for the hypothesis space. And out of that huge hypothesis space, out of many number of functions, we actually need to pick one function. And that is why we need to refine our search. And for that reason, we are having introduced here the concept of inductive bias. And under inductive bias, we are having two kinds of biases, restriction bias and preference bias. I hope you must have understood the concepts. If no, please let me know.
Ma'am?
Yes.
Do preferences are like weight, means weight we have, means weightage we have given to something input which is important, like?
It is not weight that we are providing for any kind of feature. It is, you might be knowing the forms of polynomials. Do you know the form of polynomial?
No,
how to write a polynomial function? And yes, what we mean
x,
by degree?
X plus y equals to 0 means like this, for example, we can take.
Yes, so we are having the degree of the polynomial. So if I am having a term, say x to the power 10, that is the highest degree that I am having, highest power for the term, then I may say that that is the degree of my polynomial.
Okay,
and here,
okay.
Whatever x or these kinds of literals we are using, those are in fact the variables those we are having. So if we go for higher degree polynomials, obviously complexity will increase.
Yes, yes. Got it, ma'am. Got it.
And that is why we are trying to prefer the polynomials with lower degree. So that is
right,
just
right,
one
right.
Example. That is just one example. We may have
yes.
Different kinds of preferences as well. If it is a Boolean kind of feature space, so I'm having only 0 and 1 values for my features. So accordingly, I'll be having the instance space. Accordingly, I'll be having the Boolean functions. So if I'm having my hypothesis space that includes only the Boolean functions, I may come up with some restriction for Boolean functions. So only these kinds of functions I'll be using. And also I will put some preference also on the Boolean functions, that I want to have many, only the small Boolean functions. I do not want to go with the lengthy Boolean functions. That might be my preference. So depending on whatever problem we are solving and depending on the complexity of the problem, we may define our bias. Right? There is no particular rule that this should be the bias. Depending on whatever we are solving, whatever the problem statement is, depending on whatever is the kind of data that we are having, depending on that, I need to put the restriction. Say for example, see, if I'm having such kind of a data, then I may restrict myself with the bias that I want to come up with only the linear function, because I'm looking at my training data and this training data is really suitable to have a linear function as the hypothesis. But now let us assume that, say for example, I'm having a classification problem and I'm having the samples like from two classes. Say I'm having this, these are the samples, let us assume. And just look at how these samples are spread in my space. So I'm having this as one class and I'm having another class as well, circle class. So I'll be having the samples like this. So these are my data points in my training data set. And those belong to two different classes. Got it? So if I am having such kind of a data set, then can I have a restriction? Like I want to come up with only the linear functions to segregate this data.
Oh, ma'am.
No, obviously not. Because if I look at the nature of the data that I am having in my training set, it is not possible for me to come up with a line. Right? And that will separate out my data points. So if, say for example, if I come up with such kind of a line. Let me draw it properly. So let us assume that we are having such kind of a line. Is it possible for me to separate out the data points in two classes with this linear function? No, not possible. Not possible. So in such kind of a situation, I need to put some another restriction. And what that restriction might be, I may say that I will be coming up with some quadratic function. So quadratic function looks like this. So that might be my restriction. I want to come up with a quadratic function. Right? So depending on this situation, depending on this problem that we are trying to solve, we need to put the bias conditions accordingly, right? To minimize our search, to minimize, actually this bias is actually enabling us to minimize the search space. So hypothesis, finding the hypothesis will become now a search problem. So given a huge hypothesis space, I would like to search for the best one. And to search for this best, depending on several parameters, like the nature of the data that I'm having, right? Or the problem that I'm trying to solve, the number of features, the data type associated with the features. Those are the different parameters based on which I will be having some kind of a bias. to minimize my search space. Okay, so I hope that the point is clear. Still, if
yes,
you
ma'am.
Have any doubts, please let me know.
No, ma'am.
Otherwise,
you can continue.
I'm going to proceed. Okay, fine. So, as I mentioned, inductive learning. So now I hope that the point is clear once again. Inductive learning, we are inducing a general function from training examples. So we are going to induce the data samples, and out of those data samples, we are coming up with a function that is most suitable for prediction. So to construct the hypothesis H, to agree with the concept C on training examples, we are having this inductive learning with many different kinds of algorithms. So what I mean by that, given the data, we need to come up with a generalized function from that training examples. So this function that we are inducing is nothing but the hypothesis, and we denote that hypothesis with this H. And our hypothesis should agree with the concept C on training example. So what we mean by concept, let me tell you what we mean by concept. So if my training data is having the samples those belong to two classes, say positive class and negative class, then in this inductive learning process, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to learn the concept. And here I may say that concept is this positive sample, positive class, plus class, positive class. That is a concept. So this class or the samples belonging to this class are having certain properties. And in inductive learning, what I'm trying to do, I'm trying to learn this concept, to come up with some hypothesis H. And later on, after learning this concept C, this might be my concept. So we are just abbreviating this concept as C. So given the training samples, given the training data, I need to learn these concepts. So just I have given you the example, the concept may be this, these samples of say class positive. So I need to learn, what is this class positive? And whenever I learn this, right, that learning can be used to predict unseen samples of that concept. Those belong to that concept. So afterwards, if there is a sample presented which belongs to this positive class, due to this concept learning, my hypothesis will predict the class of the sample accordingly. Right, that this sample belongs to this plus class, positive class, or this sample belongs to the negative class. Right, next, one more concept, that now we are just finding out the hypothesis, or we are just finding out the function, general function, from the training data set that we have. So we are having two more terms here. A hypothesis is consistent if it agrees with all training examples. I'll repeat. A hypothesis is consistent if it agrees with all training examples. So what we mean by that? Suppose we are having some samples, positive samples. And if we are having some negative samples, we are having some positive samples and we are having some negative samples. And based on this training data set, we are trying to come up with a hypothesis. So let us assume that we have come up with this hypothesis. This is a line, this is a linear function. Just for the sake of simplicity, we are considering this example. So I will say that this hypothesis is consistent if it agrees with all training examples. So if it agrees with all training examples, what I mean by that? If I come up with this hypothesis, right, then definitely if those many samples I'm having in my training data set, every sample is classified correctly. So whatever is towards left hand side of my hypothesis, those are positive samples, and whatever is towards right hand side of my hypothesis, those are negative samples. So it is possible for me that this hypothesis, or I have come up with this hypothesis that agrees with all the training examples. So there is no error. All the samples in my training data set are being classified correctly with this hypothesis. And that is why I will say that this hypothesis is consistent with respect to my training data set. Do you agree with me? And the next concept is hypothesis is generalized. So what we mean by hypothesis is generalized? So I'll say that a hypothesis is said to be generalized well if it correctly predicts the value of y for unknown sample. I'll repeat. A hypothesis is said to generalize well if it correctly predicts the value of y. Y is my output for unknown sample. So sometimes we may come up with a hypothesis that may not be consistent, right? That may not be consistent. What we mean by may not be consistent? Meaning there are some training samples, right? Let us assume that we are having this positive sample towards this side of the hypothesis. So if this is my training data set, and if this is my hypothesis, I will not say that this hypothesis is consistent. Why? Because it is not agreeing with all the training examples. Because this training example will be misclassified if I am having this hypothesis. So this is not consistent. But I may say that this hypothesis is generalized. Generalized well. So what we mean by that? Even though while training, I'm having some misclassification, I'm having some error, right? This might work well for unknown data. This might work well for unknown data. So a hypothesis is said to generalize well if it correctly predicts the value of y for unknown samples. Right? So for this hypothesis, which is not consistent, right? If I provide some unseen data, let us assume that I'm having one positive sample over here. This is unknown. Okay? But my hypothesis will classify it correctly. Let us assume that we are having the negative sample here. So once again, this hypothesis will classify this sample correctly as negative class, right? So if this hypothesis, I'll say, if this hypothesis is generalized well, then it will correctly predict the value of y for my unknown sample that was not seen earlier. And usually we need to come up with such kind of generalized hypothesis. We do not only need to make sure that whether my hypothesis is consistent with respect to training examples, But we should also make sure that my hypothesis is generalized one, so that whatever I present afterwards, which is unknown, that also need to be correctly predicted. Right? So this is what the concept of the hypothesis being consistent and the hypothesis being generalized. And we really would like to have our hypothesis, those are generalized. If they are consistent, it is really good. But what we are more interested in is our hypothesis should be generalized. Right? And that is why we are having here one statement. Usually, this inductive learning problem or inductive learning is ill-posed problem. So why we are saying that it is ill-posed problem? Unless we see all the possible examples, unless we see all the possible examples, or unless we have enough or sufficient number of training samples with us, it is not possible to induct those samples and it is not possible to correctly come up with the hypothesis. So we say that inductive learning is an ill-posed problem unless we present the rich training data set to our algorithm, to our learning algorithm. So the basic necessity of our inductive learning is we should have enough number of training examples. Those belong to all the categories, those we are trying to address by making use of this learning problem. So unless we see many examples, unless we see enough data while learning, it is not possible to come up with a good inductive learning algorithm or a good solution for the problem. I hope the concept is clear. If you have any problem, please let me know. These are very basic concepts, and every time, whenever we go for any kind of learning algorithm, we need to look for all those concepts. We need to check whether my hypothesis is generalized. We need to check whether my hypothesis is consistent. We need to check whether the data is enough for learning. If not, we need to induce more and more data. So please let me know if you have any doubts. Yes, any doubts?
Ma'am, is there any example, real world example of where hypothesis is consistent?
So this is actually the real world example only, no, that I'm saying, giving here. I'm having the samples belonging to two classes.
You created this example.
So this, you can relate it. Say for example, I'm having some data set, right, related to the prediction of cancer. I'm having some data set that is related to prediction for cancer. So I'm having my training data set wherein I'm having, say, thousands of examples or thousands of samples. So every sample is having some features associated, whatever it may be. And every sample is having some class, maybe positive class or negative class. Here what we may, what is positive class? That means the person is having the cancer. If I'm having negative class, I'll say that the person is not having the cancer. Or let us try to relate it with COVID-19 cases. I'm having the data set related with lots of COVID patients, or not necessarily COVID patients, but many people. Few are COVID positive and few are COVID negative. So whatever I'm saying here positive, that means this sample relates with COVID positive patient. And whenever I'm saying this is negative, this means that this sample is meant for COVID negative person. So this is this kind of data I'm having. And if I'm having this kind of a data, what I need to do is I need to learn from this data. Depending on the features, I'm trying to learn. I'm using some algorithm, machine learning algorithm, to learn this data. And afterwards, whenever I'm presenting the data for a person, new person, and I want to detect whether the person is positive or negative with respect to COVID-19. So what I need to do? I need to have the data with respect to that person. So meaning, whatever are the features, I'm having some values for that particular person, for those attributes, those features. So whenever I present that kind of a data to my machine learning algorithm, my machine learning algorithm will tell me whether the patient is COVID positive or whether the patient is COVID negative. So that is a real world example. And if I'm having such kind of a hypothesis while learning, right? And if while learning, I'm able to correctly classify my training examples, that is consistent. And if I'm having the hypothesis, that is, even though in the training, I'm having some errors, but it is generalizing well. So for unknown samples, if I test my machine learning algorithm for unknown samples, then if it is giving me predicted results, then I'll say that it is a generalized one. So that is a real world problem. And always to solve such kinds of problems, we are making use of machine learning algorithms. And with respect to every such kind of learning algorithm, we are supposed to make use of these terminologies. And that is why we are trying to learn that. This is what you expected? Real world problem?
Yes, ma'am. But what I was thinking, in real world problem, there are some exceptions. Means in that we cannot say that a hypothesis will be consistent. So that was I was thinking.
So that is, see, that is what I'm trying to emphasize so far. So if this is my data set, and if this is a noise in my data set, what I mean by noise? It is something different. This is something exception. So if this is a noise, and if this is my hypothesis, then obviously this sample will be misclassified whenever I try to learn. And this is how I'm saying that my hypothesis is not consistent. So there are the situations, not necessarily while training my model, I'm getting 100% accuracy. If I'm getting 100% correct results while training, then I'll say that it is consistent with training example. My hypothesis is consistent. But that need not be the case always. Sometimes it may happen that my training data is noisy. Noisy meaning I'm having some exceptions in my training data. So not necessarily my hypothesis is giving me the correct result for training. But why it is happening? Because there are some noisy samples. There are some noisy examples in my training data set. But even though my training or my hypothesis is not consistent with respect to training example, it may happen that my hypothesis is generalizing well. And the reason is because whatever afterwards I'm providing to my learning algorithm, it is predicting the correct results. So my hypothesis is generalized well for the unknown samples.
Yes, ma'am.
Because it is giving me the correct prediction. I hope I'm able to convince.
Yes.
In very simple terms. If you still have any doubts, please let me know. Otherwise, we are going to conclude this session because I think we are out of time. Is there any doubt?
No, ma'am.
Yes. Everybody, is there any doubt?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Okay. So let's try to conclude this session. In the next week, we are going to look at the performance metrics for learning algorithms. So how to evaluate the performance of my machine learning algorithm. So that is what we are going to discuss next, right, in the coming week. So I hope you have gained some insights about the terminologies. So let's conclude this session. Thank you very much.